All right. Hello and welcome to our fourth webinar called Dissecting Business Models for the Circular Economy. I'm glad you've joined us today. And with me today is my colleague Charles Joannik. Hi, Charles.
Hi, everyone. Hi.
As well as always, Michael Gnoss, our IT head, basically, who will manage the chat for us. So, starting tips for today. First of all, as always, you will receive the presentation. This time, however, and I can show that we do the webinar within Miro, our virtual collaboration tool, which you can basically see here. And that is our tool of choice for doing all the workshops, as well as working with the tools and templates we will show you today. And you will get access after the webinar to that board where you have all the information and more details than we can go into today at your fingertips, basically. As well, as always, we are happy to interact with you. We are looking forward to your questions. So feel free to post them in the chat and in the Q&A section of this webinar, or write Charles or Michael directly. Michael, especially if you have issues with the technological side. So today we will be talking about business models for the circular economy, and we will look at two examples in depth to show you how we approach these and to show you two examples that we think are very interesting and educational. For starters, I want to go through the tools and basic methodology that we use for this. For those of you who have already joined us before, you probably know that, so I will go to it quite quickly. For one, we need to know about business models. So what is a business model? We use that business model triangle here, which has four dimensions. One in the middle at the center is the customer. So who is my customer? What are his needs? And on top, we have the dimension what, so the value proposition. What are we offering him? What needs do we help him with? And what kind of products and services do we offer him? We have the how dimension, which describes how we are generating that value via the value chain. And the dimension value, basically, which describes the revenue model, so how we make money based off of it. However, as we've seen it, as I've talked about before, this is a very a view on the company, a very internal view on the company, which basically excludes the environment. So we have thought on one of the methods and we want to include here, and we have included here, is the triple bottom line, which focuses on people, profit, and planet as the three main aspects and dimensions within which every one of us, as well as the company, have to act and which we have to acknowledge, which is why we have incorporated them into our sustainable business model concept. And it looks like that. So basically, in addition to the four dimensions, we also have the impact dimensions. Because whatever you do with your business model and your company, you have an impact on the planet, people, and the profit as well. Just to give you one example, what you are offering and producing with your company and how you produce that has an impact on the planet. Think about environmental pollution, but also the material and products you bring out into the world. Apart from that concept, of the sustainable business model, we need to talk about circular ecosystems. You probably have seen this slide before from us. Basically, what we want to highlight here is that there is not one business model that can create a circular economy, but these are multiple business models and oftentimes multiple companies who work together to basically close the loop, close the material loop. And this requires interaction as well as oftentimes orchestrators, so companies who set it up and who make sure that everyone is working together on this. What you've also seen from us most of the time is how our framework works. So we have 7 phases within our framework that help to design and shape and create such ecosystems and the accompanying business models with it. Today, we will use these tools, so the business model, as well as the circular canvas, to show you how you can, for once, take a look at certain circular ecosystems and the business models they're in, to learn about from them, how you can use the patterns that we have identified and basically designed, how to use them to analyze existing business models and to better understand how and why they work and get additional insights that hopefully you can apply to your own company or your issue or project at hand. The circular canvas is basically the combination of the material flow as well as the business logic behind it. So in the outer part, you have the take and dispose area, and you have the logic of make, use, and recover of the value chain, all centering around a product or a shared value proposition that is described by this logic. And in the corners, you have aspects such as the design of the offering or product, which need to facilitate this interaction to basically be able to get the products or materials back. Another very important aspect are the metrics, as well as financing and packaging and logistics, which we say are overarching and highlight and are important for all the aspects within the ecosystem. So, starting. The first business model we want, and please feel free to ask any questions about the tools and the templates, etc. But I went quickly through it because I believe most of you know them already. So the first business model we want to take a look at is Seri Industrial. Seri is an Italian company, and they describe, as you can see below, their mission is to accelerate the energetic transition to sustainability and decarbonization, controlling the entire supply chain of electric accumulators, so batteries and plastic material. These activities shape a fully integrated cycle and recovery of raw materials, representing a unique example of circular economy. So it's a relatively young Italian company that was founded in 1999 by the Civitillo family, which is still owning it today. And we think it is quite an interesting example for the circular economy because for once they have established a big part of a circular ecosystem and are trying to get into a second one. So taking a deeper look at it and how we approach these basically. If you want to approach such a business model and find out more about it, we usually do that by looking first at the ecosystem. You have to understand what you're getting into or what the current status is. And for today, we have chosen Seri Industrial because they have already established a circular ecosystem, or a big part of it, and are taking part in an ecosystem, namely the lead-acid battery ecosystem. So how does a lead-acid battery system work? Or first off, why? The lead-acid battery ecosystem is nearly closed at the moment in Europe. I think much more than 90% of all the lead acid batteries are currently brought back. And Seri Industrial is an interesting example because they basically followed the path of an integrator, which is a typical or one possible role within circular ecosystems. And the integrator basically incorporates the value added activities as much as possible. With Seri Industrial, they acquired a lot of companies that are active in that ecosystem and help to close the loop and have basically used and created these synergies to take a bigger part and realize a bigger part of the value chain. So what has Seri done? I don't want to dive into too many details here, but basically Seri in 1999 started as an industrial engineering consulting company. And 2 years later, they started their Seri plant division, basically offering turnkey plants for recycling exhausted lead acid batteries. And we are quite successful with that within Italy, focused on Italy, building some plants and growing quite a lot, but overall changed 10 years afterwards, which is quite interesting, started to change and acquired Plastamid ICS, which basically are for molding and molding plastic and creating components for the lead acid batteries. And over the years, as you can see here, they have acquired more and more companies. Highlighting I want here is FAAM, which is basically a company that is producing lead acid and nowadays also lithium ion batteries. So they have come from the consulting part to the plant producer to basically creating the product that what they want to offer, and have in 2017 acquired an ex-Whirlpool plant, which they are using for the next step, but we will dive deeper into that on the next slide.
Richard, may I jump in and ask a question? Yes. What can we learn from the timeline here? What are the key learning or the key aspects we can take out of the development of the company?
Yeah, sure. So basically, what we see here is, for one, that we see quite the acceleration. So 10 years of business as usual here on the left side, and then from 2010 onwards, we see more and more activities within the company, which is what we see a lot nowadays, because currently there's a lot of pressure on companies, increasing pressure regarding sustainable solutions and also regarding requirements in that part, and also more attention with regards to circular economy. And we see many companies that try to position themselves and are getting more and more active in that area. We see that also in the lithium battery area, where we have companies that went from basically mining and integrated more value chain steps, because that is the way forward. And if you have started on that way, you gain the synergies and benefits of that integration. Many companies try to move forward with that. All right. So how does the actual ecosystem look like? So you can see here in the circular canvas the main activities, and we'll not dive into the corners or design and metrics for now, but we're talking about lead acid batteries for industrial equipment and cars, so the big ones, just to make it more manageable for the time being and for this webinar. And we start with mining the lead and the other components, basically. These mining resources are basically raw materials are used within the component manufacturing, meaning all the handles and all the covers for the batteries, and also obviously in the battery production itself. These batteries are then moving on to OEMs, in that case, either car manufacturers for the car batteries, or for Seri Industrial, they're heavily focused on forklifts. And these cars or forklifts then go on to machine dealers or car dealers, basically, or directly to consumers. Nowadays also for cars such as Tesla, but mainly for forklifts and other stationary and equipment, battery equipment usage, where the batteries are in use. For example, the forklifts are used. And for these industry appliances, we see oftentimes maintenance services which are offered, and which also include maintaining and when we focus on the battery ecosystem here, a take back of old batteries, while cars often visit repair shops or are sold at car dealerships, and sometimes even graveyards, scrapyards, what happens here is that for the lead acid battery ecosystem, which is very important to understand, in Europe at least, we have a deposit scheme in place. So I think it's 750 euro per battery that you get back, basically. So they have integrated that for some years now. And this ensures that at repair shops, so basically when you change your battery because it's defect or empty, etc., it can be easily brought back and collected via collection services and then enter the chain again. So part of it, depending on how that is implemented in different countries, the batteries are collected and then brought to the correct recycling facilities where they are dismantled, and some of the plastic gets back, or it is already integrated in the collection role. And here, as we said before, it's interesting that the lead acid battery ecosystem is nearly closed, which has a lot to do with the toxicity of lead. So it's heavily regulated, and that has helped a lot with forming this ecosystem. And we also see which is typical for a circular economy, that some of the parts, while they are brought back for the components, they're often also sold and handled outside in the new ecosystem. So this is usually, taking a step back, the first step we do. We look at the current ecosystem. In that case, it's quite nice because this is already a closed loop. So what we want to do is here take a look at how Zeri Industrial has handled that. And overall, based on the history, we see that they have integrated a lot of activities right into their corporate. The plant division, which was one of the first acquisitions and carve-outs, is basically selling and creating and building battery recycling plants. And the most important one, the main aspect here is FAAM, because they are basically the producer, which I talked about already, the production of the lead acid batteries, while also handling the battery recycling at the production sites. And one of the more difficult aspects of circular economy is how you get the batteries or your products back, right? And Zeri Industrial place themselves quite well here, because for once they have service and maintenance contracts, especially regarding their forklift usage, where they handle a lot of the maintenance of the forklifts and swap out batteries. So that way they get their hand on the old batteries and can bring it back themselves. And they also have CarBat, which is basically a battery repair shop or part of the repair shop, and offering for swapping car batteries. So they can, that way they get back, and due to the deposit system, it usually is handled that way, and all the regulations, that it's quite easy to get for them to get their hands on the batteries, which they then use at their recycling facility, and for once bring it back and use the lead and the other metals to produce new batteries, while using the plastics and this plastic scrap and at their recycling company or firm, which basically is partly used for their component manufacturing. So ICS is producing the covers and handles and all the outer parts of the larger lead acid batteries. And the other part goes out of the system, and they have placed themselves with Zeri Plus, which basically does a lot of polypropylene components for the automaker's car industry. And CoS is doing a lot in the naval and other areas, producing mainly pipes and fittings and so on. So they use all of the parts that are coming back from the used batteries here. I've seen some hands going up. Are there any questions right now, or can we go to them later, Charles?
I think we can go on.
All right, great. So that's basically a big look into an overview of a player who has already placed themselves firmly within the working circular ecosystem, which is, from my point of view, always nice to see. The next thing we want to take a look at is basically what are they up to now? Because we've chosen this this example not just because they have already established that, but also because they are currently looking into emulating or reusing that concept for the lithium-ion battery market. So they basically want to replicate their ecosystem in that area as well. What they have done is basically came up, and I've talked about this before, they bought an ex-Whirlpool site. And with FAAM, they acquired a lot of knowledge about lithium-ion batteries. And they have basically are starting in the next months, if it goes as planned, with the production of generation one lithium-ion batteries, which are soft pouch batteries. So basically an older generation, which is currently oftentimes used for industrial applications still, as well as their forklifts. So they have stayed quite close to where they're good at, with the idea that, as you all know, for the electric vehicle market, the Asian players are currently the big ones. And they've already scaled up very well. And so their goal is to first focus on a niche, on niche applications that also need tailor-made solutions, which is why they're focusing also on storage, naval or military uses, and have invested themselves 55 million into that project to come up with a capacity of 300 megawatt hours per year, which they intend obviously to scale up. One important part here is also they have secured their supply with a joint venture in Argentina. And this is the first step that they intend to do. The second one is then, if that works out well, they target to go from that niche market to more of a mass market. This is made possible by the current focus on the battery ecosystem, namely if they are funded with more than 500 million euros by an IPCEI project, which stands for Important Project of Common European Interest. So they basically have big money, as Europe and the EU is focusing on getting that ecosystem and up and running, and trying to, let's say, not close the gap to China, but maybe not let it widen anymore, which is why their goal here is then to come up with generation three and four batteries. So generation three is what you basically see right now also in the EV, in the cars, electric vehicles, and generation four is still out in the future. And they want to scale their capacity up to 2.5 gigawatt hours per year. For context, that's first Tesla Gigafactory in Nevada is right now producing around 35 gigawatt hours per year. So it's really not as big yet. But what's also interesting is they also plan to have the battery recycling within that facility. So basically learning from their ecosystem and the parts before, they want to replicate that and make sure that they already are positioned to close the loop here. And as it's the first pilot line, learn from that and maybe expand on that. Taking a deeper look, what we use for this is the idea sheet, and we have a circular idea sheet here, and I will zoom in a bit. As we don't have too much time, I do not want to go into all the details here, which is why we are happy to share the board with you afterwards. What's important from our point of view is that, for one, they have a clear face. So just for your context, we have the dimensions who, what, how, and why from the business model, as well as planet and people from the triple bottom line, to basically make sure that we include all the important dimensions we've seen earlier from the sustainable triangle. What they are doing here is basically replicating the system from before. So they are producing the customers are producers of forklifts, buses, bikes, etc., where their first generation batteries can be used. And in addition, they offer maintenance services, etc., as well, to basically get back the batteries like before. What they also saw, which is the main driver here, is basically that most of the cell cost in the lithium ion battery system right now come from the raw materials. So they believe that they have a competitive advantage here to act locally, which brings us neatly to our next part. And these are the patterns. So we've talked about before that we use the patterns for once to come up with new ideas for the ecosystem to basically be able to close the loop. And for very industrial, we see 7 patterns in action. One, obviously, recycling, which is the core of the business. Production is core of the business, but which is core for their offering to basically replicate the lead acid battery system and also recycle the lithium ion batteries. For that, in the new model, they also need to make sure that they have the reverse logistics in place, meaning that they need to make sure to get the batteries back, which is much more easy when you are the one who produces them and who can, for example, offer maintenance services as they have done before, or maybe also think about buyback schemes. As this is quite far in the future as of now, this is not set in stone for their final business model in the lithium area. And in addition, waste as input, as we've seen before, also lithium ion batteries have different metals, but also plastics involved, and they still have their synergies, capacities and companies where they can make use of the plastics in different ecosystems and use them as an input for their pipes and other products. Maintenance and repair is still a core pattern here, as they still target in their first step forklifts and other applications where they also provide the maintenance services, and that allows them to get the product back basically for recycling. And localization is another pattern we see with them, because due to the EU funding and their positioning in the Italian market, which by the way played a big role for getting that funding, they have the advantage, and they aim to have their recycling facilities on site and close by to their production facilities. And at the same time, they also act more locally than current recycling offerings, which are basically in China or Asia. And that also played a part in their financing. So one of the more common patterns right now we see for monetizing the loop is basically crowd, and in this case, public funding, because the EU is very keen in developing and creating that industry within Europe. They took advantage of that basically, and were able to reduce a lot of their investment risk involved due to that funding. And maybe the most important pattern here is that they offer to be a solution provider. So basically, you buy their battery and get their maintenance, and you don't have to take care of it anymore. And they create that they take care of that whole part from apart from the use phase, basically. So except for production of the, for example, forklifts, and using these forklifts, they take care of everything else with regards to the battery here. All right. What we are always interested to see, if you have taken a look already at the patents we have, and maybe use the chat. If you see additional patterns that from your point of view, Theory Industrial is already using, or if you see other business logics that, that spring to your mind when you take a look at that. Summarizing, yeah, Sean?
Yeah, I just wanted, because we could maybe, what could we learn from this example, from the analysis? Like, what are the main key takeaways for the people there in the audience to take from this example?
So for one, what we've seen is that starting with the ecosystem is always a good point, and oftentimes the most important point, because oftentimes companies don't have that holistic view, which is necessary to create circular solutions. Here we already presented a circular solution, but usually you do not have that in place, and you need to make sure to have an overview of all the players, but also mainly the activities and roles that are involved in that ecosystem to come up with solutions. So if we use these patterns not to better describe and take a look at existing ecosystems, we see that it's important to use these to come up with a whole new ecosystem. And in that case, we see a focus, and this is natural in that case because they're coming from recycling, they stay with that approach and that that part. But we also see that if you want to take a new take on it, you could look into the other closed loop patterns. For example, you see not from Theory, but from others, that product reuse is also a common theme there, where they try to find different applications for old batteries and reuse them, especially the larger ones. So that might help. And so these patterns, while we use them here to describe what's going on, can help you when you take a look at maybe also competitors out there, describe what patterns they are using right now. You can use some of the same to basically come up and maybe improve on their solution, but mainly also take some other patterns that have proven successful and try to differentiate yourself from these competitors in the future.
It's interesting, because if you have a look at the way they have been developing from lead batteries to lithium batteries, it's a typical approach that companies have when innovating their business models or thinking in business model portfolio, where once you have like one successful business model on the market, you try to reproduce this business model into other business units or market niche, whatever you're offering. And we can clearly see that they're basically play the role as an integrator on the one market, and now they're playing the role of an integrator in the next market, because they've been successful at doing it the first time.
Yeah, that's what you often see. It's important to be maybe aware of that you're doing that, because you oftentimes still need to adjust and if you enter a different market, but at the same time, it's where your competencies are. So it's good to take as much from that that existing model as possible into the new one. So some insights, and maybe you can join us with that. and tell us what you've seen. But basically, what we saw with that is that a step-by-step approach that they have done. So basically going from their plant and doing their pilot plant and going to the next one while focusing on a niche here helps them to not take too much risk, right? And at the same time, what we see in a lot of sustainability areas right now, public funding plays a big role, which again allows them to maybe scale quicker than they would otherwise, but also in addition reduces the risks, right? So that's a big opportunity for many companies in different areas, try to anticipate and maybe see where the society and also the public opinion is heading, to identify where you could, with your existing capabilities, add value. Because when the regulations come in and when funding comes in, it helps you to be early and to position this yourself quite quickly. And as Charles has already said, they showcase a typical move using their existing business model and applying the logic behind that to a new area, which is obviously not that far away from their core business, and use their existing capabilities also to have a better offering from the get-go in place, because they already can handle all the plastics and they already have maintenance services for forklifts and other applications, so they can easily offer these to basically the same clients and customers, which basically upgrade to different batteries here. And we see that with other competitors as well. All right. So much for our first example and case. As I said before, we have the idea sheet as well. So there we have taken an even deeper look into that. And I highly recommend you to use these kind of tools and templates, because they help to structure your findings and see what's out there. So we use them basically when you come up with a new ecosystem to think more deeply and more in depth about your own business model that you want to apply in the upcoming ecosystem. So in that case here, we have the producer and recycler together, but also on a more higher level, describe what you intend and need from your partners and the other stakeholders in the ecosystem, so that you get a good understanding on what needs to be going on from the business model perspective. All right. If we have no more questions, let's move to the second example. And that is Infarm. So I'm not sure how many of you know about Infarm, but Infarm basically is a vertical farming startup based in Berlin and founded in 2013. And they basically built modular hydroponics, so water-based greenhouses. And they place them within the retail stores and supermarkets. The interesting part is they're quite successful right now. I think they have more than 300 million in funding. And they have now, I think they're now entering the US market and next year the Japanese market, and are in more than 10 countries so far. So it has proven successful. What makes them so different basically is that they are doing most of the growing within the stores. And that's interesting for once also from a marketing perspective, because it's a different look and feel in the supermarkets, but also from a sustainability standpoint, their solution reduces a lot of sustainability issues and problems here. And they're offered as a service model. So as we said before, first we want to look at the ecosystem. In that case, the current ecosystem, and we want to narrow it down to produce. So in that case, what Infarm is doing, herbs and lettuces. And the usual food chain looks like this. You take externally fertilizers and you need the seed producers to basically come up with the seeds on fields. You grow your produce. You sometimes have to store it. And that moves on to food processors, where the food is basically handled, then manufactured and packaged, and then distributed to retail stores and supermarkets, from where it finds its way to restaurants. And I believe it could also go directly to some bigger restaurant chains, as well as to the customer use, so into your fridge, and ends up in your kitchen, obviously. From where the rest moves to local waste collectors, or if you're conscious about it and have solutions there, you compost it yourself. And from there it moves back. So the interesting part, and maybe that's a question that comes to your mind as well, for me when I first looked into food ecosystems and circular economy for food, was the point being, okay, that's already circular, right? because we with all what we eat, it enters the biosphere again, right? So what's the issue here? And the main point for using circular economy concepts and what we are aiming to do, we not just want to create a circular economy, but we want to create sustainable circular economy and sustainable solutions. And one big issue with the current food chain, the global food chain, is that we have a lot of food waste. As far as statistics go, I think 1/3 of the food that is produced for humans is wasted and lost, so it isn't eaten. And I think for vegetables and fruits, it's even 40% to 50%. So there's a lot of waste going on there, which obviously creates a lot of sustainability issues. At the same time, we overuse a lot of our soils, of our fields, and we basically have many middlemen in between and long supply chains and long transportation ways. So there are many issues that we need to handle, and framing that as a circular economy issue helps us to take a big look at it from a more holistic perspective. So problems that Infarm is addressing right now, there are three main problems from our point of view. One is basically that, as I said before, the path from food to the table is very far with many middlemen. You have a lot of energy that's wasted, a lot of food is wasted, and you have, due to the many middlemen, also increasing prices. As I said before, the current system is inefficient, and we have a lot of waste. And it's also centralized in Mediterranean climate zones, and therefore we have long transportation times, high CO2 emissions. And what's also interesting when you think about it, we also have different goals when compared to products. So we often talk about focusing on the customers and the value proposition for them. But if you take a deeper look into the food ecosystem and food value chain, you see that a lot of what's produced there and modified and grown is aimed at being able to survive that long value chain. So the salad and tomatoes are not treated and chosen for the best taste oftentimes, but to basically survive the long way, to be still good when they reach the supermarkets and get bought by you, the end consumer, etc. So there's a kind of misalignment between what we want in our tomato, for example, and what the whole value chain and how the whole production side has to focus on. And that's basically where at least for part of the for foods, so in that case, lettuces and herbs, etc., Infarm is a really real game changer. So how does the food chain look with them? While the right side is similar, because they do not really touch that, we see that we have a big change in the make phase. So basically, from the seed producers, they still purchase their seeds, but then they have their plant hubs where in their hydroponic greenhouses, these are bigger ones, they grow the plants from seed to very small plants, and then have just one step moving either directly into the supermarkets, into the in-store farms, or to so-called distribution hubs, where they have that same logic of modular greenhouses just scaled up tenfold. What they achieve by that is basically on 25 square meters of space, as they go vertically, they have the same output as 4,000 square meters of field or soil. So it's much more efficient, and they cut a lot of middlemen and also a lot of food waste on the way, because these are still living plants. You have nearly no waste at all from plants that are no more good. And at the same time, you also very much reduce the retail waste, because it's only gets harvested what's probably being sold. So there's a lot of reduction on that part and a high reduction in transportation and more, which is overall made possible by new technologies. So to achieve that and to do that more sustainably, it was important that you have LEDs in place. It's important that they're automated, a lot of their handling. And if we take a better look at their business model overall, and we could call it in that case, farming as a service, we see that a lot has changed when compared to normal production of these producers. For once, you could say that if we dive into the value for customers, it's much more aligned. So basically their core value proposition that they state is that they want to have fresher and better tasting produce that grew right in front of them. And offering these fresh produce from the indoor farming units with a full service system here. So what they do is basically as a revenue model, they do not sell the grown produce or whatever. They basically charge a monthly fee based on the capacity of the indoor farms used. And the rest, what they do is basically key activities include that they monitor that. So they have cloud controlled greenhouses. These are heavily optimized and automated so that they claim to have 80% automation in there. And the only thing that's left to do is basically plant the small plants into the greenhouses, harvest them, package it in front of or in the supermarket stores. And basically that's it. And that's what they're offering with that monthly fee. So supermarkets probably do not want to harvest or plant any produce and any herbs or lettuces. So that's taken care of. That's why they have quite a large workforce locally at each place, but which is also a very interesting value proposition because basically the supermarkets get a nice greenhouse there, which looks good, have fresh produce over there and don't have to care for anything else. And just need to pay the monthly fee. This is overall quite good for the planet because we said before they reduce the transportation costs, they reduce food waste, they reduce greenhouse gas emissions, use less fertilizers and no pesticides, they reduce space, and they also reduce the water use because it's a closed system with their hydroponic greenhouses, and that's much less usage of water. And for example, they also reduce the soil degradation because basically you don't need the soil anymore for that kind of use. So apart from the idea sheet, we want to take a look at the patterns involved here to get so that you can get a better feeling for all the patterns involved here, and also maybe have them in the back of your mind when you are starting to think about and generate new models and new ecosystems. So core and center is probably here the localization. So instead of going to Mediterranean countries, growing all your produce there and transporting it onto to the supermarkets with many middlemen, you have it right or nearly right at the point of sales in the supermarkets. So that's very important. Another one are the smart assets, because only that cloud controlled and optimized growing scheme where they have the possibility to further optimize all the lighting or the nutrients or the watering allows them to basically create these solutions and to handle them in an efficient way. In addition, we see the pattern increased functionality because what was once on the fields is now in the store and acts basically also as a marketing instrument. So you see it for Whole Foods and Edeka in Germany, which took it up first, who basically were able to use that as, hey, see, we have sustainable solutions, we have sustainable offerings, and which gets a nice brand touch and reputation increase. We already have some questions. Let me finish with that, and then we'll answer everything. Eco-efficiency, they reduce the water usage, and they also, to make it not an energy issue, they currently use 90% renewable energies, and they plan to do 100% by end of next year. And obviously, detox as a pattern, because you have no pesticides and heavy reduction in fertilizers. Which also helps with a lot of issues when you think about creating fertilizers and phosphor, et cetera. From a revenue model perspective, subscription-based solutions. So you subscribe to basically the based on the capacity you use and you want to use. I talked about the hubs they have. So you do not need to put that greenhouse into your store or not, or can also source more from them. So they have local larger hubs where they with big storage holds, basically where they grow their produce. You can source this directly from there, also based on the capacity that you basically subscribe for. And overall, that's the solution provider, right? Because they bring you a tailor-made solution. They bring you just the produce. You have to not handle it. You do not have to harvest or plant it. So basically, the only difference for supermarkets, if we take a look at that, is that they don't buy per lettuce and charge with a margin, but basically have a production capacity they buy and get the sales from that. We can see that it's including experience selling, because it's a different experience for us customers. And they are able to customize the offering. So basically, the supermarkets can decide what to grow, and it can be optimized towards also what's sold, so that you adapt to the needs of the customers of that specific local supermarket. And last but not least, it also signals that the supermarket cares and looks out for sustainable solutions overall. All right, so insights from here. What we see basically, as this is a B2B2C, more honestly, it's very important, because we see with the circular economy, marketing is always a very important aspect. Right now you oftentimes see a lot of greenwashing, but here it's very nice, because you basically, your offering is also a marketing strategy at the same time. We see here with that example that supply chains can be shortened significantly with new technology, enabling local offerings. And we with BMI Lab always like to use these to stimulate your curiosity and also creativity, because you can use these and think about, okay, what kind of technology would offer for my case, for my company, or for my idea or project, more local offerings? How could I implement these kind of solutions, local solutions and smart connected solutions, to improve not just the offering, but also to improve your offering from the sustainability standpoint, which also allows them to basically have a cost efficient solution. I think overall what they're offering is a bit more pricey than the usual lettuces, but not by that much. And it's appreciated due to the higher quality. And last but not least, think about services. So without the additional services, which when you think about it is much harder to scale, because you have to have your people on the ground within every city and area you go to. But without that, the solution wouldn't work for supermarkets, for example. So it's important to take that into consideration and offer the services and additional services that make your solution different and make your solution work. And maybe as a small question here, what I'm interested in, if we think about these localization schemes and these offerings, maybe drop us a note or an email or in chat just where you think similar offerings are maybe already in place or could be working, where the advantages would be similar, because that always helps us and yourself to train yourself in applying these patterns and coming up with new ideas here. All right. A shorter Q&A session. As always, I have a bit too much to talk about. So maybe as a quick reminder, we have our offering on the CircularNavigator.com website. You can follow us on LinkedIn. We have now a newsletter, a monthly newsletter, where we look at the current topics and news and give our insights and perspective on that. And now we are coming to the Q&A sessions. So are there any questions, Charles or Michael, from the audience here?
Yeah, sure. They just got a question in. What kind of impact can material resource passport can bring in the building of circular ecosystems in the future?
That's a good point. I think these approaches are highly valuable. So as referring to the battery ecosystem, there are initiatives out there. I think the Global Battery Alliance is currently developing that and putting money into that. And I think that's what you also see in plastics. Basically, to be able to close the loop, you need to understand and steer and control the material flows, right? And oftentimes with finished products, we have hundreds or thousands of materials within. So it's really, really difficult to get them to work. And that is also an aspect for recycling. If we want to recycle or recover or refurbish, we need to understand what products are in there, how hard it is to dismantle them, to reuse them, if there's any toxicity issues, etc. So I think that is the most difficult part, because as soon as you can close that gap and close the loop profitably, our economy and our system basically works, right? So there will be companies that will offer these solutions, and they will basically do that. And so passports and insights into all the materials are the tools and that are needed in many industries to make these solutions work in the future. All right. Good. So I hope I think we had some raised hands here, so feel free to drop us a note in the chat. But overall, I hope I could give you some insights for one into how to use the tools. Maybe you got an understanding of why these are helpful and important. And basically, feel free to keep in touch. And I'm looking forward for exchanging on all these ideas. So feel free to connect on LinkedIn or drop us an email if you have any further questions regarding this. So that's it from our side, right on time. So basically, thanks for joining us today. I hope you had an insightful webinar for yourself. And I'm looking forward to see you in the next webinar, which is probably in January 21, but we'll keep you posted. Thanks for joining us and have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Bye.